Tonight, Perth breathes easy. Partygoers celebrate as masks are removed. But there are fresh vaccine supply concerns as pharmacists scramble to keep up with demand. Plus, Tennis Australia in damage control over the Novak Djokovic saga as his lawyers claim he was medically exempt after contracting the virus for a second time. Serious concerns for a missing newborn in desperate need of urgent care, taken from hospital by her mother. The moment an out-of-control car slams into a Beachborough property, the three-second impact that caused carnage, and farewelling the actor who changed Hollywood forever. Sydney Poitier dies at 94.
This is Nine News Perth with Natalia Cooper.
Good evening. Pharmacists are concerned their vaccine supplies are running low, admitting they're struggling to keep up with bookings across WA. It comes as preparations are finalised for the sale of rapid antigen tests on Monday, but there's a warning for those looking to stock up.
Smiles as bright as the sun, in full view with masks stripped away. The state government mandate lifted from 6 p.m. yesterday, allowing vaccinated partygoers a restriction-free Friday night.
Very happy that all masks are done. Big relief at work.
We're all vaxxed as well, so
yes.
Feel like there's no need to have the mask on.
Today, no more community COVID spread as the state's double-dose vax rate climbs towards 86%. Instead, there's now worries about supply.
It has really struggled over Christmas, New Year, and we are running out.
Commonwealth delivery issues have WA pharmacists scrambling to keep up with the high demand, some even unable to accept bookings for the next eligible cohort aged 5 to 11.
People have been running around borrowing off each other, hunting around trying to ensure they can meet all their bookings, but that has become harder and far more difficult.
At the same time, they're preparing for rapid antigen tests to be legal from Monday. The Pharmacy Guild says it will take some time before the home kits are on the shelves, urging for shoppers to be calm and avoid unnecessary panic buying.
People need to understand there will be limits to the supply. You can't just buy as much as you possibly can. We simply don't have enough. They won't be necessary on Monday or the Monday after. They'll be necessary sometime into February.
Today's one new local COVID case is linked to a contact of a previous interstate arrival, while four close contacts from the Hyatt Hotel's Omicron spread are still being tested, as more data is revealed to suggest our health system isn't ready for February 5. 586 clinical incidents were recorded in WA hospitals last financial year, a 16% increase, with 147 resulting in death.
This points to a health system which is under extraordinary pressure. Health workers who are continually being asked to do more with less.
Elective surgery has now been scrapped right across the eastern seaboard. Doctors in New South Wales say the case burden is crippling.
We absolutely put that down to the kind of complete removal of restrictions that happened in mid-December.
The state had 45,098 new cases, all from positive PCR tests at clinics. But for the first time, Victoria got a look at the true picture as its system to log positive home tests came online. More than 51,000 infections were recorded, half from traditional PCR tests, the rest diagnosed by a week's worth of rapid antigen tests.
However, we should not rule out that there are still undiagnosed cases out there in the wider community.
Current modelling suggests the Omicron outbreak could peak by the middle or end of January, just as our walls come down. Joshua Dorr, Nine News.
Malcolm Turnbull has joined Josh Frydenberg in testing positive for COVID as Australia's total number of cases since the pandemic began approaches 1 million. Workers in isolation will soon be able to use a positive rapid test to claim financial support, but the eligibility criteria is being tightened.
The Omicron wave has reached startling new heights. Australia's daily cases passing six figures for the first time. More than 116,000 infections reported in the past 24 hours.
The numbers are really enormous, but the important number is hospitalisations and death. That's what we should be paying most attention to.
2 weeks ago, leaked Doherty Institute modelling predicted the worst-case scenario would see the nation hit 200,000 cases a day by the end of this month without the return of medium-level restrictions. Now past the halfway point, but experts believe the tide can be turned.
All the efforts that the government are making will mitigate the spread of Omicron. There's no doubt about that. Individuals are making a lot of effort themselves as well, limiting their social circles.
Australia's political circle isn't immune. Treasurer Josh Frydenberg and former Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull are both in isolation after testing positive.
Every person catching COVID, I wish them a swift recovery.
For thousands of workers in isolation, the eligibility criteria for the pandemic leave disaster payment is being tightened. Previously, a flat $750 payment was on offer for anyone who'd lost income. From January 18, it only applies to those who have lost 20 hours of work or more. If you've missed between 8 and 20 hours, the payment scales down to $450.
This is making sure that we're targeting the payment.
But you no longer need a PCR test to prove you're sick.
A rapid antigen test will be acceptable as long as the person has registered that test.
Labor claims employees have been left in the lurch because rapid antigen tests are in short supply.
We're seeing a real crisis occur around this country.
High infection rates offer one glimmer of hope. Some epidemiologists believe they could accelerate the end of the pandemic.
The light that burns twice as bright burns half as long.
Hopefully, we will be seeing the end of the trauma of this pandemic very shortly, but we do have to bunker down for the next couple of weeks.
Eliza Edwards, Nine News.
Tennis Australia is tonight in damage control, accused of giving Novak Djokovic misleading information before he tried to enter the country with a medical exemption. Lawyers for the world number one claim he contracted the virus for a second time last month.
It's not Novak Djokovic, but fellow unvaccinated detainee Renata Voroncova spilling the beans on the embarrassing saga from the Park hotel room she calls a prison. It was fairly simple, she tells Czech TV. Tennis Australia gave us the conditions to meet the exception, and I had COVID in December. A previous infection is almost certainly the same exemption Novak Djokovic claimed he'd been granted before having his visa cancelled and sent to the detention hotel. It could be the smoking gun leaving Tennis Australia boss Craig Tiley in the crosshairs, appealing to staff in this video message.
We've chosen at this point not to be very public with it, and simply because there is a pending lawsuit
and a potentially damning paper trail pointing to misleading directions. News Corp papers publishing this Oz Open information sheet sent to players in December stating recently recovered cases may be eligible for a temporary medical exemption where vaccination can be deferred until 6 months after the infection. The problem is that contradicts Federal Health Department advice to Craig Tiley in November. It reads, people who have previously had COVID-19 and not received a vaccine dose are not considered fully vaccinated. Health Minister Greg Hunt told him the same thing.
There's a lot of finger pointing going on and a lot of blaming going on, but I can assure you our team has done an unbelievable job and have done everything they possibly could according to all the instructions that they have been provided.
As Novak fans make themselves heard. Last night, they rallied in droves outside the detention facility, while today, they were harder to come by.
Free, free the refugees!
His mother leading the chorus from Belgrade.
Novak is, I think he said that he's okay, but I'm not so sure. But he's mentally very stable and he's waiting.
And as the number one prepares for night number three, inside he's found support from foe.
I don't think that's right. That's why I'm using my platform now to say, like, we've got to do better. We have to do better. It's not really humane, is it, what's going on?
as the man in question breaks his silence. Thank you to people around the world for your continuous support, Djokovic posted to social media. I can feel it and it is greatly appreciated.
He wants to play while Volokova just wants to go home. This is her leaving the hotel tonight en route to the airport. She was granted entry by Border Force and has been playing lead-up matches in Melbourne, only to be tracked down and detained yesterday. That backtracks, yet to be explained.
In terms of how people got into the country, that's a matter for the federal government.
While for Novak Djokovic, his reputation precedes him.
If he's allowed to play the Australian Open, I don't want any bar of him. I reckon he's going to be pissed off.
Adam Hegarty, Nine News.
Police hold serious concerns tonight for a missing newborn taken by her mother from a Subiaco hospital. Joshua Dorr, the premature baby has been without urgent medical care for 5 days.
Yeah, Natalia, the baby girl was born at just 36 weeks here at King Edward Memorial Hospital, and it's now been almost a week since her mother, 32-year-old Coral Edmonds, gave birth and then fled with her child through a fire escape here at the hospital. Police now hold grave concerns that if she isn't returned soon, things could go drastically wrong.
Police are appealing to Coral to please come forward. Please attend to a police station or go back to the hospital to ensure that your baby is being well looked after. The baby needs to have 3 hourly feeds because the baby was born prematurely, and the best place for that is in our hospital.
It is believed the pair are still in the Perth metropolitan area. Police tonight urging Coral Edmonds' family, if they've been in contact with her, to come forward and assist police. Natalia?
OK, let's hope they're found soon. Thank you, Josh. It took only a few seconds for an out-of-control car to cause crash chaos in Perth's northeast overnight. The driver was filmed running away from the smash as police quickly locked down the suburban home.
The moment an out-of-control four-wheel drive slams into the side of a Beachborough property. A three-second impact causing thousands of dollars damage.
We just heard a big, like, crash. My mum thought someone was breaking in until we turned on the lights and there was a car parked in the backyard.
With the SUV wedged into the bushes, the driver flees. Also captured by the motion detection security camera.
We didn't know if anyone was in there or injured, but once we checked the camera footage, we saw him running away.
Leaving behind this chaos on Sacramento Avenue.
I could hear a noise and I was thinking, like, well, that's unusual. It's scary because, like, you know, they could come into our house or something.
Police say the Mitsubishi Pajero was stolen from a home in Ballajura 3 weeks ago. These number plates are false, taken from another car in Forestfield 2 days ago, before crashing in Beachborough just before 2:30 this morning.
He's come straight through the back fence and straight into the backyard. He's taken out the shed, as you can see behind me, and hit one of our trees.
As officers spend the night scouring for clues, today the homeowners launched their own investigation into just how much damage the late night crash caused. Well, the Beachborough family is insured, meaning their fence and their shed will be replaced, but what isn't covered is their hard work and the days it'll take to clean up their backyard. The car now in police possession as the manhunt for the runaway driver continues. Kelly Haywood, Nine News.
A young man has lost his life in a devastating accident in Sydney. The 20-year-old was beachside with his girlfriend when he slipped and fell from a cliff overlooking Coogee.
A summer day at Coogee Beach, but on the picturesque rocks overlooking the coast, tragedy unfolding. Police rescue scaling down a cliff as the rescue chopper winched in paramedics in an attempt to reach a young man. He'd fallen 30 metres. The 20-year-old had been with his girlfriend enjoying an afternoon by the beach. The pair went for a post-lunch walk to see the view when he lost his balance and fell.
The patient has sustained fairly significant head injuries, was in cardiac arrest. With the water washing up on the rocks, it was very difficult.
Beachgoers on the cliff line watched on as rescue teams made an urgent mission down. Police carrying out CPR, but the young man couldn't be saved. His distraught girlfriend finding some comfort in the arms of stranger Mary Claire Moron.
She was in really big shock. She told me they had lunch down there and they walk up the hill and they go near the cliff.
The whole thing was a shock to her. It happened so quickly. She's being treated by ambulance officers as we speak.
Davina Smith, Nine News.
A 35-year-old man has been charged with grievous bodily harm over a suburban stabbing in Mirrabooka yesterday afternoon. Officers were called to the scene along Dryandra Drive, where a man in his 40s had suffered several superficial stab wounds to his head and upper body. His injuries were not life-threatening, and the cause of the incident is still being investigated. He lived a life of firsts, the first black actor to become a major movie star and the first to win an Academy Award. Sidney Poitier broke the colour barrier in Hollywood, paving the way for a new generation of actors. The silver screen icon has died, aged 94, after a career spanning six decades and 50 films.
A trailblazer who broke down Hollywood's racial barriers.
But you think of yourself as a colored man. I think of myself as a man.
Sidney Poitier, the first black man nominated for an Oscar in 1959. 5 years later, he made history.
I stand up.
Collecting the statue for Lilies of the Field.
It is a long journey to this moment.
Well, Anne Bancroft, actress, kissed him on the cheek. There was controversy in even surrounding that.
In 1967, a time where segregation prevailed across America, Poitier starred in three films that changed the national conversation. Alongside Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn, he played a black man with a white fiancé in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner.
I love your daughter. There is nothing I wouldn't do to try to keep her as happy as she was the day I met her.
A teacher in a tough London school in To Sir With Love.
You're not in trouble, are you?
No, sir.
And in the heat of the night as Virgil Tibbs, a police officer confronting racism while investigating a murder.
I'm going to take you over to Brownsville and put you on the bus myself.
You aren't taking me anywhere, you dig? You're holding the wrong man.
Those films became the roots of his legacy.
He showed America and the world what black range looked like, what it was like to be smart, charismatic, witty, beautiful, dynamic.
Poitier was born on February 20, 1927 in Miami and raised on a tomato farm in the Bahamas. He taught himself how to read and write, and when he arrived at Hollywood aged 22, he took words off the page and gave them new life.
It is the actor's job to create the essence of the man.
Remembered for his elegance, integrity and quiet dignity, a true pioneer on screen and off as a champion of civil rights. An ambassador for the Bahamas, the country in mourning, the Prime Minister ordering their flags to fly at half-mast.
We know the world mourns with us. Sir Sidney's light will continue to shine brightly for generations to come.
Knighted by the Queen in 1974, a US Presidential Medal of Freedom in 2009 from Barack Obama, the former president leading the tributes. Through his groundbreaking roles and singular talent, Sidney Poitier epitomised dignity and grace, revealing the power of movies to bring us closer together. From Oprah, for me, the greatest of the great trees has fallen. My honour to have loved him as a mentor, friend, brother, confidant, wisdom teacher. Whoopi Goldberg said, he showed us how to reach for the stars. Lenny Kravitz, your excellence will always be the benchmark. And from Viola Davis, no words can describe how your work radically shifted my life. Survived by his wife, six children and eight grandchildren, his success shattered the stereotypes that held Hollywood and society back.
40 years I've been chasing Sidney, they finally give it to me. What they give it to him the same night. I'll always be chasing you, Sidney. I'll always be following in your footsteps.
In the United States, Alison Petrowski, Nine News.
Let's get a check of the weather now with Kelly Haywood. And Kel, it started heating up early.
Oh, it certainly did, Natalia. We did reach our top of 31 degrees at 11:30 this morning, and it's slowly, though, been dropping since then. Now, at midnight last night, we were just sitting below 28 degrees, and it did drop down from there. We saw our overnight minimum of 21 degrees at around 5:30 this morning. It then jumped up to 30 degrees by 11 a.m., peaking at our maximum just half an hour later. And right now, after after some relatively strong winds today, it is hanging around 23.7 degrees. Now, it was a cool summer's day across the suburbs too. Those along the coast didn't quite reach the city's maximum. Mandurah getting to 29 degrees, and after 56 kilometre an hour winds on Rottnest, we saw it reach a top of just 25. Garden Island reached just 26 degrees. It was a bit warmer in the eastern suburbs though. Swan Valley 33 and Bulls Brook 34 degrees. Now, it was a relatively mild summer's day in comparison to what we've seen of late, but we do have some more hot days ahead of us, but I'll have more on that coming up soon. Natalia.
Thanks so much, Kel. Next, Perth's abalone fishing frenzy. From Yanship to Mandurah, hundreds rush our waters for a 60-minute ocean delicacy dash. A truck driver's lucky escape seconds before his semi-trailer goes up in flames. Dozens rescued from flood waters as ex-cyclone Seth dumps 600 millimetres of rain in just 12 hours. And police report a spike in people using Apple's AirTags for stalking. The first abalone fishing frenzy of the year saw 10 rescues along WA's coast. Fisheries busted dozens, breaking the bagging limit, with two men facing prosecution over this morning's 60-minute scramble.
Caught out getting too greedy. Abalone is a highly sought-after seafood. It's expensive and they're limited. Each licensee is restricted to just 15 per bag.
The kids will demolish these in about 5 minutes.
It's even tougher to catch them, hundreds braving the coast from Yanchep to Mandurah.
So there's plenty out there, just on the reefs, but a lot of them are where the waves are breaking.
Well, how are the conditions out there?
Rough. Got entangled in a few other people and the reef and a few tumbles, exhausted.
Yeah, I've got a few scrapes around on my legs. It only comes around four times a year, so you just got to make the most of it.
The annual abalone sacrifice, thankfully, hasn't turned fatal this summer. Surf lifesavers still needing to perform more than 600 preventative actions, 17 cases of first aid and 10 ocean rescues along the coast.
There's more swell than what I expected. However, the visibility is pretty good.
I tried to lock myself in, but the waves just kept on coming.
I don't think it's that risky if you've got the right gear. Just get in there with a knife or a screwdriver.
The risk is worth the reward for these enthusiasts. Abalone is one of Australia's rare ocean delicacies and highest valuing seafood products. It can retail for $100 a kilogram.
That's why fisheries watch your every move to find those feeling a little selfish.
You should be allowed to get 20.
Two dozen people were slapped with $200 fines for exceeding the limit, with two men now facing prosecution after being sprung at Shoalwater Bay in possession of 79 abalone. Zarisha Bradley, Nine News.
A 70-year-old truck driver has narrowly escaped his vehicle moments before it went up in flames on the Tonkin Highway in Ballajura. It's believed the semi-trailer ignited, caused by a tyre blowout. Police closed one lane while fire crews extinguished the blaze. The driver didn't suffer any injuries. Six children have faced court after they allegedly stole a car and then crashed it outside East Perth Police headquarters overnight. The Volkswagen Golf was spotted earlier in Como driving beside a stolen Nissan X-Trail. Police Air Wing eventually caught up with the group in Coolbelup. They tried to outrun officers but were tracked down by the dog squad. Queensland is in the grips of a flooding emergency, with one man killed and more than a dozen others missing. More than 600 millimetres of rain fell in just 12 hours in the state's worst flooding event in more than a decade.
Property after property inundated and surrounded by water. The lifeline crew on their way to rescue a family trapped in their home. An elderly couple inside a rescue basket winched to safety. This family of four spending the night in their car, roads around them flooded in. They too were airlifted to safety, and this is why. Nobody could have or did predict the worst of ex-tropical cyclone Seth. The remnants of the system crossing Wide Bay in the middle of the night, slow-moving and constant, dumping more than 600 millimetres of rain on some regions.
Unbelievable. Never seen so much water before in my life.
A 22-year-old man killed, swept away while attempting to cross floodwaters. Dozens of others were lucky to escape.
She's got outside her car, took a couple of steps and it's gone.
The force and volume of the torrent is astonishing, ripping up slabs of the Bruce Highway north of Gympie.
We're trying to find a way to go up north.
There wasn't one. The Wide Bay Highway disappearing underwater too, leaving many families with no choice but to sleep in their cars. For now, it's a waiting game. The Mary River continuing to rise, raging downstream to Maryborough, which is next in the firing line.
Oh my gosh.
The situation here in Maryborough is being taken incredibly seriously, with the peak still to come tonight. A makeshift flood levee is being set up in the main street in town, and sandbags have also been brought in by the pallet load. Jordan Fabris, Nine News.
These popular devices are used to attach to your belongings to track where they are if you misplace them, but they're now being used in a sinister way by abusive ex-partners. Australian police have seen a rise in reports by victims finding the tags allegedly placed by former spouses in places like cars or bags. Experts say you'll get a notification on your iPhone if an unknown tag is travelling with you for a while. Next, a drastic order from Kazakhstan's president as his country nears the brink of collapse. Armed forces called into UK hospitals as Omicron cases soar. Meet the clever craftsman tasked with creating the Australian Open's top prize. All the way around Australia on a surf ski, the woman on a six-month ocean odyssey. And how smartwatches are helping COVID patients recover at home. Dozens of protesters and security officers are dead in Kazakhstan after the president issued shoot-to-kill orders, branding thousands of protesters as terrorists. The brutal crackdown backed by troops from Russia and Belarus.
The president's orders played out on the snow-covered streets of Kazakhstan. Security forces told to use lethal force without warning against protesters who were being branded bandits and terrorists. President Tokayev saying they have to be destroyed and that will be done soon. The scars of days of protest are etched on the streets of Kazakhstan's largest city, where 20,000 demonstrators took to the streets, burning government buildings and setting fire to emergency vehicles. To crush the insurrection, military units from Russia, Belarus, even Kyrgyzstan are rolling in, sparking international concern.
Once Russians are in your house, it's sometimes very difficult to get them to leave.
This Kazakhstan resident saying she's scared and it hurts to know young people are dying.
The killing of police officers and others is unacceptable. The killing of demonstrators is as well.
Almost 4,000 people have now been detained in the country's worst unrest since independence. In London, Karianne Greenbank, Nine News.
Three men who chased and killed an African-American man in the US have been sentenced to life in prison, two without any chance of parole. Ahmaud Arbery was jogging in Georgia in 2020 when a father, son and their neighbour chased him down and shot him while recording the vicious attack, the case sparking fury at racial injustice across America.
He left his home apparently to go for a run, and he ended up running for his life.
The three men will next month face a second trial of federal hate crime charges. A judge has dismissed a complaint against former New York Governor Andrew Cuomo of forcibly touching a woman. The 64-year-old was accused of groping a female aide in late 2020. She is one of 11 people to accuse the former governor of misconduct. He denies any wrongdoing. Armed forces are being deployed to British hospitals to help fill staff shortages. Around 200 military medics will help doctors and nurses with patient care as general duty personnel fill gaps in other parts of the health system. While tents have been set up outside hospitals in Palermo, Italy, which is recording 220,000 cases a day in an attempt to ease the pressure. And Germany is developing a plan to make booster shots mandatory for going into restaurants and bars. They're works of art which will soon be in the hands of champions at the Australian Open. Tonight, we take you inside the Precious Metal Workshop, where trophies for the Grand Slam are crafted by hand.
It's an art as old as time, but very few
have the golden or silver touch. The cool jazz tunes of Miles Davis, spurring inspiration as these craftsmen gently cut, spin, shape, and polish precious metal, celebrating 110 years of W.J. Sanders by creating our most coveted trophies in tennis.
It's a big year for us, but it's a challenge that we've taken, you know, in both hands and run with. There's the Norman Brooks, there's the Daphne Akehurst, there's the men's doubles, women's doubles, mixed doubles. They're all handmade.
From mine to market, parent company Pallion does it all. Silver dug from the ground at Mount Rawdon in Queensland before being transported to the Sydney refinery. In fairy floss-like form, it's carefully raked into tubs, then sent to the furnace.
It becomes a liquid, and from there we can shape it to anything we like, and we produce what we call granules.
Each of these tiny grains is 99.95% pure, the absolute minimum standard.
We actually even produce things up to 99.99% silver purity.
More than a tonne of silver produced every day. Back in the workshop is where the magic happens.
I'll just run this up again.
The first port of call is typically Sparrow.
77-year-old Sparrow earning himself the title of Metal Whisperer.
There's nickel, stainless steel, they're all hard. And then gold's the hardest.
A fascination since he was a teenager, now an old-school tradesman with an element of romance.
You can hear the metal start to sing back off the chuck, and it makes this like echoey noise, and you know you've got a beat.
The metal, it's almost a living organism when you're working with it. It'll tell you when it's had enough. And if you don't listen to it, it will quite literally bite you in the bum.
This is the first time every Australian Open trophy has been made under the one roof. 155 hours spent crafting the Daphne Akehurst, 250 on the Norman Brooks. These works of art soon to be in the hands of world champions.
Patience and passion equals perfection. Tiffany Genders, 9 News.
An Iron Woman is about to embark on her most intense ocean odyssey yet, paddling around Australia on a surf ski. Bonnie Hancock's hoping to complete the 16,000-kilometre mission in 6 months, and that'll break a world record.
This isn't a journey for the faint-hearted. Bonnie Hancock is paddling on a surf ski for an average of 10 hours a day, hoping to circumnavigate the country in record time.
We're hoping it's going to take 6 months or less. The current record is 10 months and 22 days, so I've definitely got to get back before that.
Not only is the journey physically exhausting, there are also elements of danger out of her control. She's already had a close encounter with a shark.
The boat decided not to tell me, but just sort of keep watch of it, which I think is a very good idea. I said, I don't particularly want to know unless I have to. So that was very close to me.
As a qualified dietitian, fueling her body is a major priority. Bonnie is consuming 10,000 calories a day, which equates to 10 large pizzas. Her partner, Matt Palmer, will be there for every stroke. He's a strength and conditioning coach, and he's making sure Bonnie's body can handle the demands.
It is a challenge for me to sit back and to watch Bon go through the pain and the struggles, and at the end of the day when we do pull her onto the boat, it's a really nice feeling. So, yeah, super proud of her.
There are two goals for Bonnie's mission: make history and raise money for charity. Danica Mason, 9 News.
Next, the Australian Hospital program that's helping thousands, and how an everyday device is changing the way we treat COVID at home. And on a busy highway, a jaywalker a long way from home. But first, Bonnie Rayner's here with sport. It was a sense of deja vu at the SCG.
Natalia, 2 days ago we were celebrating an Usman Khawaja century on return, and today he's done it again. Double trouble, Khawaja tons up as a giant West Aussie finds form. Fans flock to Fremantle Oval for a summer crosstown clash. And Barty at her best, the Aussie one win away from more silverware. Usman Khawaja's return to Test cricket has gone perfectly to script. The left-hander today scoring his second century of the SCG Test. At stumps, England reaching none for 30, chasing an unlikely 388 for victory. The Aussies needing 10 wickets on the final day to take a 4-0 series lead.
4 days in, finally some Sydney sunshine. Australia making the most of it, cleaning up England's tail quickly.
The captain settles.
Scott Boland dismissing centurion Johnny Bairstow.
Edge and through to the keeper.
The late-blooming quick, once again the best of the bowlers, taking 4 for 36. The Aussies holding a 122-run lead heading into the second innings. Quick runs were needed from the top order.
Big dive at square. Harris timed the ball well, really well.
David Warner only got three of them.
That is out. Wood gets Warner.
With aggression came risk. Yeah! Harris, Labuschagne and Smith providing entertaining.
Hooked away in the air. And it sails over the rope.
But short cameos. Before Usman Khawaja.
Yes. Takes it on very impressively.
And Cameron Green teamed up. Fresh off his century in the first dig, Khawaja was in supreme form. With confidence and freedom, he played shots right around the ground, using precision and power.
Goes long into the leg side and all the way.
Twin tons capping off the perfect comeback.
There it is. Raised up. He moves into special company.
It's a surreal moment. I've never got a back-to-back hundreds in first-class cricket, let alone Test cricket, so it's pretty special.
Khawaja finishing on 101, Green 74, Australia declaring, leaving England a mammoth task just to survive. Openers Hamid and Crawley making it to stumps.
That's a classic. That is a beautiful cricket stroke.
But the tourists face a full day of all-out attack from the Aussies tomorrow. Luke Duffersey, 9 News.
Will Pukowski has returned to the batting crease nearly a year to the day since his last match. The one test opener suiting up for Melbourne in Premier Cricket. The 23-year-old initially scratchy, having recovered from shoulder surgery and another bout of concussion, but soon managed to find his groove. Pukowski eventually dismissed for 40 from 68 deliveries. The AFLW season is underway, Richmond winning last night's season opener against St Kilda. Locally, the Eagles and Dockers are currently battling it out at Fremantle Oval, which is where we find Jake Battrick. Jake, it's been a tough contest so far.
It certainly has been, Bonnie. It's been a real arm wrestle in the opening half. Both sides missing crucial opportunities in front of goal, but it was Dockers veteran Ebony Antonio who got her side on the board late in the opening term. A great start there for the Dockers. That goal breaking open the game with the tackle count dominating so far. Crowds are still lining up to get in well into the second quarter. Around 6,000 fans are expected to pile into Fremantle Oval tonight. No vaccine passports have been checked though. The rules scrapped an hour before bounce down. Dockers coach Trent Cooper welcoming all fans no matter what colours they're wearing.
And hoping a bit of the opposition as well, which we don't normally get here, so it'll create a really good atmosphere in this great venue.
So, Bonnie, but a great start for the Dockers. They're up by 17 points at halftime. This win's so important before they hit the road for over a month.
Yeah, a long trip on the road facing them, Jake. Thank you very much for the update there. Ash Barty's dream Australian Open preparation has continued. The world number one through to the Adelaide International Final after another dominant victory. Barty crushing Poland's Iga Świątek 6-2, 6-4.
Unreal. Honestly, it's so much fun playing out here tonight, and Iga is an exceptional champion. She made me play my best tennis, and I felt like we both played pretty well, and it was, I mean, really, really not a lot in it.
Nick Kyrgios will start his season at this week's Sydney Tennis Classic, given the green light to take part after overcoming a mystery virus.
I don't actually think I was able to compete fully. Like, I was scared that I'd go on court and feel tired and lethargic. And then obviously, you know, I didn't want people thinking, oh, like, he's not trying, or I didn't want to deal with that bullshit.
Kyrgios cleared of COVID-19, the Sydney tournament to be his sole Australian Open lead-in event. It was a tough day for the Aussies in the NBA, Patty Mills scoring just 3 points as his Brooklyn Nets went down to the Bucks 121-109. Former Adelaide 36er Josh Giddey finishing with 10 points as Oklahoma City were beaten by Minnesota Timberwolves 135-105. Awesome to see the girls in action down there at Fremantle Oval. Natalia, we'll have all the wash up from that game tomorrow night.
Yeah, thank you so much, Bonnie. Next, from coast to coast, wild winter weather blankets the US in snow, plus the technology helping thousands of Australians survive COVID at home. And Kelly Haywood, we're in for a slight reprieve from this hot weather tomorrow.
Well, with some cloud developing overnight, Natalia, we'll only hit a top of 27 degrees tomorrow, but it'll heat right back up again next week. But I'll have more on that coming up soon. Welcome back. Well, a perfect summer Saturday today, especially for those set to return to work next week. We hit a top of 31 degrees by 11:30 this morning, and we didn't drop to our overnight minimum of 21 degrees until about 5:30 this morning. Right now, it's hanging around 23.4 degrees. Now, taking a look at what we can expect for tomorrow, now troughs over WA's north will bring with it showers and storms to the Kimberley and parts of the Pilbara, while some parts of the southwest can also expect showers. Now, they will also push through to the metro with some cloud cover as well. Now, taking a look around the nation, Darwin will see a top of 34 tomorrow. Brisbane, showers and 29 degrees. Sydney, a possible storm and a top of 27. Now, after severe storms in Melbourne today, the cloud will clear for them and they will see a top of just 23 degrees. Canberra will be 27 and Adelaide a top of 31. Now, back home in WA's north, we'll see a top of 34 in Broome, 37 in both Kununurra and Karratha. Now, further down the coast, Durian Bay is likely to see a top of 26 degrees. Clouds will move in over Bunbury with a top of 27. Esperance getting 17 to 21 degrees. Now, for a Sunday out on the water, it will be another windy day ahead with a warning in place for winds. Seas will reach up to 3 metres and swells is looking at 2.5. Now, across the city tomorrow, we'll have some relatively strong southerly winds and that will see our clouds clearing. Now, we're likely to hit a top of just 27 and then into a minimum of 16 degrees overnight. Now, come Monday, it will start to heat up again. 30 degrees will be the top. Tuesday and Wednesday, we'll see a top of 36. Thursday, it will start to cool, 29 degrees. And then we'll see out the week of Friday and Saturday, both just 29 degrees. So we do have some warm days on the way, but we have some cool nights too. So there is plenty to look forward to, Natalia.
Yeah, I prefer that forecast to all that heat we had over Christmas and New Year. Kelly, thank you so much. That's Nine News this Saturday. Thanks for your company. A Current Affair is next. Enjoy your evening. Good night.